What's up, interview hackers? Sam here from bytebybyte.com, and in this video, I want to talk about how these little mistakes in your interview are perceived by your interviewer. And I want to help you think a little bit more about when you're making small mistakes, when little things come up, how do you make sure that you're getting the most out of the interview despite that? How do you make sure that this isn't negatively affecting your interview? And how do you make sure that you're getting the best results? So, this question the other day, and the question was, how is making syntax errors taken from the interviewer's side? And I was thinking about this, and initially I was like, you know, it's not really a big deal. A syntax error by itself is not going to really make or break your interview. It's not a huge problem. And I stand by that. But what I realized is that it actually goes deeper than that. And what it actually really comes down to at the end of the day is that first impression that your interviewer has of you. When I'm evaluating something, when I'm evaluating an interviewee, everything that I think about that person is based on that initial impression that I have of them. So initially, I'm going to get an impression based on how they talk to me, how they show up in the room, what they look like. I'm not necessarily, you know, trying to judge them or like prejudge them without having any information, but there's just a natural degree to which I'm gonna have some expectation of them based on all of that initial information that I have. And then that expectation is gonna be something along the lines of a spectrum of how well I think they're going to do in the interview. And what that means is that if I have this expectation that they are going to do well, then I'm more likely to write off small mistakes. So let's consider this example of making a syntax error. If I think someone's really smart, if they seem like the kind of person who's going to do really well and their goal, and I expect them to like nail their interview, then I'm expecting that if they made a small syntax error, that it wasn't really a big deal, that it was just a small mistake that, oh, obviously that person would have caught it if they were in a different situation. Oh, obviously if it wasn't an interview and it was less stressful, they would have been able to, you know, fix that problem, they would have caught that bug. And so I'm kind of making assumptions. Whereas on the flip side, if I have a negative initial perception of the person, a negative first impression, I'm going to view it in the opposite way. I might potentially say, oh, well, obviously they made that mistake. Obviously, like I expected them to screw up and so here they are, they're screwing it up. And so that initial perception that I have is going to affect so much of the way in which I perceive the interviewee. And so with that in mind, I wanted to actually take today to talk about three different things that you should be thinking about when it comes to making small mistakes in your interview and when it comes to making that best first impression you can. And so the first thing that I want to suggest to you guys is a strategy that you can use to help make a better first impression. And this is a technique that I call the doorway technique. And the idea here is that every time you walk through a doorway, you want to put your shoulders back and you want to smile. And what does this do? So the doorway technique is a really simple strategy because when we see someone, when we interact with someone for the first time, that confidence of like having their shoulders back, standing tall, and that like kindness of smiling and being like warm and having that aspect about you is really going to have a major impact on how we perceive the person. And the reason that the doorway technique works so well is that doorways are a trigger. Doorways are going to trigger you every time you walk through a doorway. You're going to be going into a new room. You're potentially interacting with new people. And we walk through doorways regularly throughout the day. So it triggers you to say, okay, let me reset. Let me engage, because this is not necessarily something that you're doing naturally. It's not necessarily something that you're going to be thinking about throughout the day. And it's really easy, as we know, we say like, oh, well, I'm not going to bite my nails, or I'm not going to, you know, do whatever bad habit I have. And then, you know, an hour later, you catch yourself like in the middle of doing it, right? So we need to have those triggers. We need to have something that's going to force us to think about doing things a little bit differently. So the doorway technique is really valuable. Number two, think about in the beginning of your interview, just how you're engaging with the interviewer. What kind of conversation are you having? Are you giving them one word answers? Or are you really being thoughtful and thinking about how can I engage with them? One of the things that I like to think about when someone asks me a question is there a way that I can answer this question so that it can lead to follow-up questions?
So one of the things that's hardest for having a conversation and maintaining a conversation, as I'm sure everyone's been in this experience before, it's like you ask someone a question about something and they're like, yes, or you're like, no, or maybe. Or they give you these one-word responses that you can't actually do anything with. You have to just keep asking these like prying questions. And so like if I asked you, you know, how are you doing today? And you just say, good. Then now you're putting the onus back on me to continue the conversation. Because I am no longer, you're not giving me anything. Whereas the way that I like to think about it is there a way that you can take the little question that you're asked and turn it into something that they can work with? Something that could potentially find connections. Because what you're really doing is you're like putting like tendrils out to try and basically find what can we connect on? What is something that we have in common? And so what I might do is if someone were to ask me like, how are you doing today? You don't want to go on for like 10 minutes, but I might be like, you know, I'm doing pretty well. I got stuck in traffic for like an hour on the way to work because I live on the other side of the city and I was taking the highway and there was this big accident or something. Like I'm totally making up a story here, but it touches on a lot of different little things about myself. I'm like volunteering lots of random little pieces of information. Like I live over on the other side of the city. I commute to work. You know, you can think about how you can volunteer little pieces of information as you go along, because that's a great way to connect with the person and it's going to make them like you more. And there's a lot of research that shows that if someone likes you more, they actually are going to think that you're smarter, which is crazy to think about, right? But if they think that you're smarter, then that all comes back to how they are perceiving you throughout the interview. And now finally, the third thing that I wanted to sort of bring this back full circle to this idea of like, what if I make a syntax error in my code? What if I screw up some little thing? What if they give me a hint? And the most important thing that you can do is realize that that's going to happen no matter what and not get bent out of shape about it. Because so often I see people will make one little mistake in their code. They'll screw up one little thing, which just happens, right? That's why we have debuggers. That's why we test our code, because there's some, I forget what the study was, but it's like even in production level code, they found that there is on average one bug for every 10,000 lines of code. And so it's like even in code that is tested thoroughly, there's still mistakes. There are still things that are not right. So if you're writing code in a high pressure situation on a whiteboard without testing it, of course there are going to be mistakes. But what I see a lot of people do is that as soon as they find a mistake, as soon as their interviewer maybe points it out or they notice it themselves, they clam up. They like go inside because they're like, oh my gosh, I just totally screwed this up. They're totally thinking I'm an idiot now. I'm never going to be successful. And then they break any sort of rapport that they had with their interviewer. They start getting in their own head and they're unable to continue because they're just stuck. They're like, well, and it makes their mind go blank. And so one of the most important things that you can do is recognize that these things are going to happen and you just got to move on. You just keep going. You accept that it happened and realize that it's not a big deal. Because especially if you do the other things that I talked about, if I have a good perception of you to begin with, those little mistakes are not going to make or break your interview. You making one little syntax error, you forgetting a semicolon or doing this or doing that is not going to make or break. If you can't solve the problem, or if you clam up and you're like, you know, you're halfway through, you make a little mistake and then you clam up and you stop answering the question, you're unable to get to a solution, that's where we run into issues. That's where I'm like, oh, well, I probably can't pass them because they never came up with a working solution that I can actually say definitively that they know how to solve this problem. And so this is what I want you to start thinking about is how can I make a really great impression so that I can skew the odds in my favor? Because again, you can make the greatest impression in the world, and if you don't know how to solve the problem, it's not going to help you, right? It doesn't paper over everything, but when you have that, when your interviewer has that clear perception, then everything that they are thinking about you is colored by that perception. And so you want to try and control that perception as much as you can, and if you do that, that's going to really help you throughout your interviews. So that's all I got today. if you want to make sure that not only are you nailing that like perception side, but that you're also able to solve the technical interviews, I'd highly encourage you to check out our 50 coding interview questions guide, bytebybyte.com/50questions. We go through 50 of the most common coding interview questions that you'll see in your interview. We've had a ton of people download that, so I highly recommend it. Thank you all for joining me, and I look forward to seeing you again in the next video.